This is PSA TV. We are live here. Joining me on set this morning, I've got Jaffar Howie, no stranger to the media, of course. He's like been accepted to Princeton University for engineering. We're not really sure which engineering just yet. So good morning to you, Jaffar.
Good morning, good morning.
How are you this morning?
I am tired.
Yeah, no, we literally dragged you out this morning.
It's okay. It's fine. It's fine. I have to get into the
I think at some university. Point, exactly. What time would classes be starting across
eight,
the eight?
No. Yeah, eight.
Oh, we,
eight.
We're just...
So this is 1 hour
it's
to
good. It's good. It's
okay.
Good. This is just a prelude into your classes. Who exactly is Jaffar? I mean, the media would know you, of course, as this boy who got accepted into Princeton. I mean, it's not every day you see something like that in Trinidad and Tobago. So you've made your mark in the country, and from my end and from a lot of people's end, you're one of the country's role models. So first of all, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Just going back to what we were talking about, who exactly is Jaffar?
Well, my name is Jaffar Howe. I'm 19 years old. I grew up my whole life in Laventille, Corey Street. I went to Sacred Heart Boys. I have a little brother and a little sister. After Sacred Heart Boys, I went to St. Mary's College, where I started playing water polo and I started swimming. I was a member of the national water polo team. Gold medal in Crifter. Skipped form three, went straight to form four, did nine CSEC subjects, got nine once, went to Cape, got nine once again. But unfortunately, I was unable to get a national scholarship because even though I did have the nine ones, I had a two in communication studies, which kind of eliminated me from the running that year. That is actually one of the reasons that I ended up applying to the US.
Yeah, I was now going to ask you if that is one of the main reasons why you applied.
Yeah, because after I didn't get the national scholarship, I had to find another way.
Yeah.
You know, that determination, I had to find another way to pursue my tertiary education. And I realized that SATs was one of those ways, you know. So I ended up doing the SAT class last minute, actually. I signed up on the last possible day that year, and I had to study for it. Had 4 weeks, ended up doing, I did well in the SATs. I got 1540 out of 1600. And with that, I decided that I would apply to some of the top schools in America.
Yeah.
You know.
I know you were telling me it's 10 universities you applied to.
I applied to 10 universities, yes.
And
I
you
was
got
accepted
through.
To five of them.
Yeah.
That includes Princeton University, Howard University, Dartmouth, NYU, and the University of Miami. Yeah. And I also took a year off to sell popcorn.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It's a very, very commendable though. Not every day you see a young man just, you know, trying to make it out here.
Yeah.
Like we were just talking about it off cam. Young people, to some extent, they need that level of motivation. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you have to motivate your own self. Who or what motivates you?
I would have to say my parents. They instilled a lot of values in me as a child that I will never forget.
Yeah.
And that determination that they instilled in me is the reason that I am here today. The fact that they always told me, learn from your failures and always get back up. And that is exactly what I had to do when the scholarship fell through. I said, okay, cool. You know, in fact, my mom, when that happened, she's really sad about it because she said, you know, I know how much you wanted this and stuff. And I told her, it's fine. We're going to find another way. And it came through, sorry. But one of the things that motivated me to do the popcorn specifically is that I have a younger brother and a younger sister, and I didn't want my parents to have to take away from their childhood in order to have to support me.
Yeah.
So I decided, you know, I'd find some other way to support myself, to take away that burden from them, and it ended up working out really well, actually, really well.
How was sales?
Fantastic. Those children and the teachers, everybody, they love popcorn.
I mean, who doesn't, right?
They love popcorn. I don't, actually.
You don't? So, wait. So you make popcorn, but you don't like popcorn?
Yeah, you know,
so,
you never.
Okay, so why popcorn then? Because everybody likes it.
Basically, there was a guy that I got the idea from when I entered TIC. When I was in about maybe Form 1 or Form 2, he used to sell popcorn.
Okay.
Right? So I'm not the original. I didn't come up with the idea.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
What happened was a friend and I, we were talking about it. And we said, well, whatever happened to him? Right now he's a doctor, by the way.
Oh, wow.
In Sandy Grande, I think. But we said, okay, why not try it out and see?
Yeah.
Why not? At the time, all I was doing was, well, no, I was applying to universities at the time, which is a whole rigorous process by itself.
Yeah, I'd imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a lot of forms.
I had to write a lot of essays, sign a lot of forms, go back and find information that years old. I was also tutoring. Right, I was tutoring some students for CSEC Form 3 to Form 5 level, physics, chemistry, biology, math, and art math, and a little bit of Spanish. But so I said, with this extra time, instead of sleeping, although you know I love to sleep, but with this extra time, I could try all the popcorn sales and see how it works, and it worked. So I continued doing it for a while. And I recently stopped, actually, recently, not too long ago.
Are you passing on the mantle to anybody?
I would. I have no idea, actually, you know, because I've been so busy over the past few weeks with preparing for university.
And I mean, not just physically, imagine mentally as
exactly,
well.
Exactly, exactly.
See, that's why you're here early, and it's a step. It's a step in the right direction.
I hope so. Because I think that the process to actually go to the university is even more tedious than the process to apply to the university.
Oh, wow.
Because now I have a whole lot of forms to sign, documents to send up to make sure that the financial information is correct.
Yeah.
You have to prepare, you have to know what it is you want, you have to connect with your roommates. They accepted me to what they call the FSI program, or the freshman scholars, which means that I do the online course.
Okay.
That is the name of the online course that I'm doing currently. That leads all the way up to the first day of school. So I'll be busy for the next few weeks.
Yeah.
You have to talk. I have video lectures that I have to do with my professors. I have classes to learn. You know, you have a final goodbyes to say.
Yeah.
To.
Are you ready for that part, though?
I try not to think about it.
Okay, we'll not think about it.
You know, whenever the time comes, I will deal with it then. Because, you know, I don't want to be too sad for the next. The next few weeks until I leave. So I just leave it until then. Enjoy everything you could, you know, go to the beach for the last time, eat in the savannah, doubles, roti, get everything you could now.
Yeah, because you're not going to get that away. Unless you cook, of course, and do you? I mean, you're going to university, and every university student must learn to cook something at some point.
I could boil rice.
Right.
And I could boil eggs too.
So that's breakfast?
That's lunch. And dinner.
Okay.
Yeah. Nah, like, I could do a little thing, you know, maybe steal some chicken. I could fry chicken.
Okay.
That's about it.
Okay.
That's about it.
You could save yourself.
Yeah, you know, make some noodles and that's all part of the experience.
Yeah.
The university experience. Yeah.
Because, I mean, spending money on food, that is an entire cost, an entire bill by itself.
Luckily, the scholarship that I was awarded.
Yeah. It covers food. Well, okay. Well, that's good. Food.
The only thing that it doesn't cover is, well, personal expenses.
Okay.
And piece of housing, which is, I think it covers 75% of my housing cost actually. So the remainder that I was raising funds for and that I was selling the popcorn for is just to cover that, and everything else should be covered by the university.
Okay. So you're looking forward to starting your new life across there? And
yeah. I'm going to try a lot of new things because, I mean, why not?
Yeah.
Why not? This is the time to really experience those things. Growing up, my parents always told me to, as much as you exercise your mind, you exercise your body.
Very
my dad
true.
Makes sure that when I go away, I know, don't forget to maintain my physical fitness. So growing up, they had me involved in so many sports. I did judo, karate, soccer. Why did I say that? To see again into the American. Language
this
one
is
time.
The Caribbean. We have football here.
Football, sorry. Football, basketball, netball, yes. Cycling, swimming, water polo. I used to run. I recently started back running the Savannah.
Okay.
For the first time in my life, I ran an entire Savannah. 21 minutes, guys. That's a record time. Yeah. But
Usain Bolt Jr. Yeah.
So when I go up, I'll try rock climbing.
Okay.
Because the school has a rock climbing wall, and I feel like if I do rock climbing, I'll never get fat. So that's my reason for trying that. We see how that goes. And I guess the school has a lot of clubs. They do have a lot of clubs. That is something that they advertise.
Yeah.
Clubs for anything. And if they don't have the club for what you want, they allow you to start it.
Yeah.
So
I always encourage young people to get involved, not just in the academics, but extracurricular
right.
activities, because it keeps you, apart from just going, it makes you a part of the
yes.
body as a whole.
Yes, yes,
so,
yeah, become a better part of the community.
Yeah.
Also, the extracurricular is one of the reasons that I was accepted to the school, because what happens is that when you apply to these Ivy League schools,
mm-hmm.
these really top universities, they don't want just
Academics,
because everyone applying is smart.
Yeah.
So how do they differentiate between smart
yeah.
people
yeah.
by what they do outside of just academics? I had to talk about that in the seminar that I hosted maybe 2-3 weeks ago about how to apply to universities.
Mm-hmm.
So like I got friends who studied at different parts of the world. So Canada, the UK, specifically Oxford, the American process, and we kind of came together and hosted a seminar. Thanks for everyone who came out, by the way. It was fantastic. But we hosted a seminar to like help give other people the knowledge, because ever since the story came out, everyone asks, okay, how can I do that?
Yeah.
You know, how do I get into these schools? Do you think I should do SATs? Should I do CAPE?
Mm-hmm.
Should I do Form 6? And I mean, I used to have the same conversation
yeah.
over and over, and I don't mind, but after like 10 conversations in the same day, then I said, you know what, I can get everyone into
yeah.
one room
yeah.
and we could just give out the information.
Yeah.
And it was really successful, actually. It's much better. I thought maybe 20 people would show up.
That's really good.
But we got like 130. Six or so.
A lot of people look up to you, especially those who may not be from like fortunate backgrounds.
Right.
So they're now like, okay, so if you can do it, I can do it too.
Right. Well, I didn't expect the reaction that I got
mm-hmm.
because I always tell people I was selling popcorn when the first person called me for an interview. And we did it over the phone.
Yeah.
So I was taking orders and handing people their bags of popcorn while someone was on the phone asking me okay, so how did you get into Princeton? What it is you need? Tell me about your life and stuff. And I said, I genuinely forgot about it because I was so busy doing other things. Yeah. And I woke up 3 o'clock in the morning and the first message came in, congratulations. I said, congratulations? For what? So they sent me the story and I said, okay, cool. And then I went back to sleep and then I woke up. And then the messages just started coming in, everybody calling me saying, hey, Jafar, we heard about you on the radio. This interview, that interview, oh, people wanted to know how they could help. I mean, I didn't expect any help at all. I just thought I was giving my story to the media. It turned out that a lot of people were moved and they wanted to give whatever they could. Some people gave advice, some people, they just gave a thanks, you know, and that, yeah. I appreciate that because it made me feel like, you know, what I did meant something to a lot of people. Yeah. I mean, I was walking the streets and these people would just stop me and say, hey, you the boy from Princeton? A lady said, oh, I just want to hug you. I just want to give you a hug.
And imagine how proud your parents are as well.
They are, but honestly, if you hear them talk, you'd realize that my dad would always tell people, because I stand there, he said, well, no, we expected this. You know, I didn't expect it, but they expected it, because he would always say, and it showed, they were always proud of me. You know, I could never fault them. They showed that support throughout, because, I mean, when I told my parents, okay, I'm taking a year off, I'm going to apply to these US universities, I really believe I could get in. And they said, I mean, my mom, she was scared,
yeah.
You know, because
she's probably like, you know what you're doing?
Exactly, you know, and applying to these universities is expensive, right?
So there's a fee attached to it,
doing the exam, there's a cost, and, you know, we talked about it, and it was as simple as, okay, you really believe you could do this?
Yeah.
Okay, no problem. You know, and that level of faith that they had in me, it made it easier to go through the entire process without someone, you know. Some people may have somebody shout and I'm saying, hey, look, I spent all this money. It was never like that for them. And that made it so much easier for me. I didn't feel too pressured to perform, because they always say, you know, once you do your best, it's fine, right? And they meant it. They did mean it. I mean, throughout everything I've done, once they feel like I did my personal best, you know, the first question when I do an exam, my dad would ask me, hey, you feel like you did your best? And I said, yes. And he say, okay, good. And sometimes I might say no. You know, and he say, okay, you know what you have to do next time, right? And just that, because they gave me that a certain level of independence at the same time to make my own decisions, to make my own mistakes. And it really, that is the exact reason why I am here right now. Because I actually applied to university twice.
As in?
2 different years.
Okay.
Which is why it was even more shocking that the second year, my mom allowed me to do it over. The first year, what happened was that I got a good score.
Mm-hmm.
I got the 1540, but it was rushed, you know. I had like a month to apply to these universities before the deadline, and I said, okay, I just apply. I didn't even know which schools I would apply to. I just told a random friend, hey, find some schools for me to apply to. I applied it. A lot of people don't know that part of the story, but and then I ended up getting into 3 out of 4 of them, but no funding at all. Right, so we were like, okay, we didn't know what would happen next. We'd say, okay, just apply to some of the universities on it. And that is why when I asked my mom, okay, let me do it one more time.
Yeah.
Right, I know for sure that I know it properly now. I started maybe 6 months in advance for applying to these universities because it was a lot of research. As I said, a lot of forms. I wrote over 30 essays.
Oh, wow.
And as we were talking about before, I said I wasn't too good with words, so the essays was a task for me. You know, I had to edit them, I had to send them to a friend, make sure he said, okay, cool, fix this and that. I said, all right, cool, come back, fix it. And it was a lot. I mean, just finding schools to apply to, right? They have like thousands of universities,
yeah,
right, to choose from, with different benefits and different disadvantages. It was a task. It really was. And then selling popcorn at the same time.
Yeah, I was now going to ask you, how did you balance everything? Your personal life, selling popcorn, applying to universities, which, like you just said, is a tedious task.
Yes.
So,
yes. Honestly, I would say that it did kind of affect my personal life, because at the same time, you're saving up to go to university.
Yeah.
So you're not really going to find yourself spending a lot of money. There's actually a point, wow, where I had my personal bank account.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because I try as best as I can to support myself and decided to take away the burden from my parents. It was empty. Right, so I walked from Movie Town to my house, which is in Port of Spain area.
Yeah.
Which is really far.
Yeah, that's a good distance.
Drink water and pie for lunch. Maybe that was like, what, $10? To spend as little as possible.
Yeah, pies for like...
like five.
Yeah.
I lie, it was a Linda's pie, so it was about 12.
Okay.
About 12. But yeah, I really wanted to spend as little as possible, and then the popcorn business kind of grew.
Mm-hmm.
It made it a lot easier for me. And my friends are also really supportive. One guy told me, you know, you're going to get into one of these Ivy League schools. And I said, how you know that? I don't even know that. He's like, I could see the effort and stuff that you're putting in. I mean, you're brilliant. They have to accept you. I was like, okay, you know, take it on. But that was a kind of foreshadowing thing.
Mm-hmm.
He used to drop me a lot of the places that I had to go because he had a
nice
car.
Yeah,
he's doing medicine now, actually, in UAE. So yeah, I surround myself with like-minded individuals, and that kind of helps to
It motivates
keep me going.
You.
Yeah, it does.
In terms of motivating younger ones as well, I know you've been doing a lot of mentorship, a lot of outreaches as well. You know, what are some of the main, I don't want to say challenges, mm-hmm. but some of the main concerns that young people who you would have been interacting with, what are some of the concerns they would have?
So one of the things I did a graduation speech at my old primary school, Sacred Heart Boys.
Mm-hmm.
I also did a speech at Silver. And also, I mean, on the streets, people talk to me all the time. This lady stopped me and said, hold on, I'm coming back, I'm bringing my son. Tell him, speak to him. I said, okay, cool. And I think I always try to speak to not just the young people, because I know it takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah.
And I try as hard as I can to get the people raising the young people into a certain type of mentality, because as I said, my family played a huge part in where I am today. Not just my direct family, my grandmother, both my grandparents took care of me while my parents had to work as a child. My uncles, they support me all the time. My aunts, my cousins were the people that promoted the story the most to help me get the support that I needed under every single post, under every single comment that someone did. One of my cousins would go under and say, okay, good, help, support.
Yeah.
And there were thousands, and they went under each one. And the youth can't do it on their own. I mean, it's easy for us to say, okay, stay motivated, never give up, stay motivated, never give up. And I would tell them the same thing, stay motivated.
But they need things at the end of the day.
You really need, it's only so much you could do with limited resources,
mm-hmm.
with limited facilities. A lot of people are discouraged because of where they come from.
Yeah.
And I mean, I try to use my story to help with that, you know, because someone told me, what you did is amazing, it's like going to the moon. So I said, why? He said, when would you ever see the words Lavender and Princeton in the same sentence? Mm. I said, okay, cool. Right? But in a way, I can understand where he came from, because a lot of people believe that
because you're from a certain place, you're not entitled to step
exactly,
out of that.
Exactly.
I think to some extent that people from those places, because it's been said so much times, they condition their mind, it's just there.
Yeah,
so now they feel a certain way. Okay, I can't go and apply here or there or anywhere because you're going to look at me a certain
exactly,
way.
Exactly. And I try to give people their options. You know, so a lot of people come to me asking, okay, so what can I do now with this, with that?
Yeah.
Some friends I know say they assume automatically they can't go to university.
Yeah.
They just can't. Say why? Well, I don't know, but I just can't. Not really making that much sense. But,
I think that's the limitation as well. We tend to put limits to ourselves.
Yes.
So we don't step out of it and we say, okay, I can't. Before you even attempt it, I can't. And words are powerful.
Exactly. Oh, gosh. My mother. My mom says that all the time as a child growing up. She, as soon as she say, Jaffa, go do this. I say, no, I can't. I say, well, how you know you can't do it? You do it yet? I say, oh, gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh. But you know, it...
I think as we grow older, we understand what it means because it's more effective.
Yes, yes. I mean, you didn't even try.
Was it old saying, don't knock it before you try it? So, I mean, we can't just be out there, no. Just like you did, step out of whatever it is, whatever situation you're in. Always know that there are opportunities out there and it's up to you to find them.
Yeah. You really
because things won't come to you, you know.
Exactly.
Nobody really is that special. I mean, you have to naturally go out there.
Yeah. And I think, speaking more now to the young people, in the world that we in now, the age of technology, we are accustomed to everything just coming right to us. You know, you sit down right there, you have the TTRS to just come pick you up, the information, the news coming straight to you. You don't need to move. You know, you could order food at your house from anywhere, right? And we're so accustomed to everything just coming directly to us that going out to find something is...
challenging.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because we forgot the actual form of communication, the first or the major form. I mean, I do appreciate technology.
No, I love technology.
I love it. But at the same time, you know, create that balance where you can't be so enclosed that you don't know how to go out there and communicate with people.
True. But at the same time, I mean, spinning off from that, I know a lot of people, and I would say I could have been in that same situation.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons, I mean, technology facilitates the fact that some people can't go outside.
Yeah.
Right? Honestly, when this story came out, a lot of people called and they said, okay, where in Korishi do you live in? Because I so-and-so, or I know people from this area, and I say, well, I never used to go outside and play in the streets and thing. Because, I mean, my parents, it was their way of protecting me, you know? But instead, they involved me in a lot of other activities.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like I wasn't inside all the time. But some people are not in a position to do that. Some people's parents may not be able to... They may not have the time to take them to these extracurricular activities. They may not have the funds, right? And in that situation where you're not in a position to just go outside and explore and stuff, you're trapped inside and the only way for you to go out is now, you know, social media, technology. So, I mean, I wouldn't blame technology alone for what's happening. But also, I mean, the crime rate. I have a lot of friends who won't leave their parents. Tell them, oh, no, you're not allowed to walk in town. Right? Say why. You know, in my brain, you know, I grew up in town.
Yeah.
I say, okay, why? But from where they come from is a whole different...
Mm-hmm.
And even recently, my mama, now she's scared to let me walk in town. I mean, I still walk in town. I'm not stopping that. But because a lot of stuff happened recently.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of stuff happened recently. And she says, okay, don't come home too late. If you're coming home late, I'll pick you up from so-and-so. Because I have custom, honestly, moving late. Right? I wake up late, I reach home late, maybe 1 o'clock in the morning,
soon.
2 o'clock in the morning. Yeah! We'll see. But, and with with what happened recently. Actually, when I was last week I was walking on Prince Street Shops. I hid him behind a car. This lady on the sidewalk, she had like a hairdressing salon, and mm-hmm. she said, "Hey, come inside." I was like, "Okay, cool." So I came inside and I sat there. I was going to meet my friend at the library,
yeah.
and I had to call and tell her, "Okay, go inside. I'll be like 20 minutes late. Some shots fired right now, you know." And that isn't even the first time. That's the second time it happened to me personally in 2 weeks. And I guess it was even a clue. I had a last year something much worse happened, and where the shots were heading in my direction, and I had to duck on a wall and all kind of madness. And it justifies the fear that people have sometimes, but I try not to live in fear, and a lot of people disagree with that. I mean, my mom disagrees with it, but I really do. I try not to let it stop me from.
But at the same time, while not living in fear, you have to be mindful.
Exactly,
this is reality. This is what is happening. You can't be that. You can't.
Yeah. You don't walk towards it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's the reality that we live in.
Honestly. Let's talk a bit about unemployment in this country, because youth unemployment in particular, because it's something that is not just high in Trinidad, but it's high in the Caribbean as a whole.
Right.
So. Growing up as a young man, where did you see yourself in a career in the first place?
So it depends on how far we're going back. As a child, I wanted to be a dentist.
A dentist.
Then I decided I wanted to be a doctor. Then I decided I wanted to be an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
Stopped with engineering for a while. Went back to dentistry. Went back to engineering, you know. But yeah, I kind of moved around because you discover new things as
yes.
you get older. You know,
yes,
new
yes,
jobs
yes,
come
yes.
up, new jobs disappear, and stuff like that. But in terms of unemployment, I would say.
How do you think our job market is?
Currently, I don't think it's that good. I don't. Because I have a lot of friends who are already trying to figure out, okay, so where it is they have to go with doctors.
Yeah.
You know. What do people who decide they want to be a doctor, what do they do?
You know what's the funny thing? We always say we have a shortage of doctors in the country. But every year you have hundreds.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if it's thousands, but I'm going to say hundreds just to be safe.
Right.
But you have hundreds of doctors graduating from university
yes.
every year. But yet we hear time and time again, there's a shortage of doctors. So it makes one wonder, well, how?
I mean, I've heard a lot of reasons for it. One of the things, speculations, is that we need doctors, but we don't have the funds
right.
to pay the doctors.
Now, as a young person yourself, who may have, you know, probably there was a chance of you getting into dentistry or mm-hmm. going in that field, how did that make you feel?
It's one of the reasons why I kind of came out.
Yeah.
You know, because I said, okay, you know, it's wonderful to go to university for 5 years, then do your internship. You go through all of this time and then you don't get a job. It's kind of difficult. You know, also you spend a lot of money.
Yeah.
Medicine is not cheap.
No, it's
super
not.
Expensive. Even with gate, equipment and stuff costs a lot. But it kind of scared me out of that field. Right, and even with engineering, I mean, we have a lot of engineers graduating.
Yeah.
And I'm still unsure about my future.
I think
future
you'll
career.
Figure it out after year one. Well, you have no other choice but
exactly.
figure it out.
Exactly.
But you'll find your niche.
Yeah.
You'll find it.
But a lot of people don't know where their next job is coming from or where their first job is coming
yeah.
from.
Especially yeah. university graduates. I mean, and I think it was last week sometime, I was talking to another young man from Commonwealth. And we were talking about the fact that a lot of people graduate with, let's say, you studied engineering.
Yeah.
So you're an engineer. But your job now is in a totally different,
completely
really.
Different.
Yeah.
Completely
yeah.
different.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have no idea. I feel like I'm not sure if it's because we don't have the funds to pay these professionals because we have lawyers coming out like mad.
Yeah.
Lawyers, doctors, and engineers are graduating at like an increased rate every year. We expanded the dentistry school actually.
Yeah.
Right? But do we have somewhere to put them? And I don't know how to feel because can I watch these young people and say, okay, no, we don't want any more of y'all, so don't study that field anymore. I feel like it's unfair to, to tell them.
Job placement has always been something that's
Which is why we have a brain drain.
Yeah.
Which is why we do have the brain drain that we have. A lot of people just want to leave and, okay, they'll get a better job out there, they'll get a better life out there. I don't know how I feel about that yet. You know, I never like to speculate and just say, okay, as soon as I leave, everything's just going to be all nice and wonderful. But I could understand where they're coming from. I could understand. It's a scary reality to know that after you put in so much time and effort, that if you don't have enough networking skills, you're not going to get a job. Not even in the field that you want to be in, but I mean, just not a job at all.
Yeah.
My friend's sister is home. I think she went to school for 7 years. I can't remember what she studied, and she's just at home because she couldn't get a job in her field. But that's just the reality that we live in.
That's a sad reality. Jafar, before we wrap things up, I'm just going to ask you, what is your advice to young people who may want to follow in your footsteps?
It's not easy. The route that I walked, it wasn't easy, but it does pay off a lot in the end. It does pay off a lot. So you really have to make up your mind that this is what you want and go for it, and don't let anybody at all, don't matter who it is, don't let anybody get in your way, because a lot of people try to stop me on the path that I was on, saying that maybe it won't work out, do the safe thing. But sometimes you really just have to risk it.
Yeah.
You really just have to risk it and stay determined.
All right. Well, it's on that note, I want to thank you so much for coming on this morning.
Thank you for your having me.
Keep making us proud. Go up there, shine as you continue doing so. And once again, thank you so much. So this is just a prelude into you getting accustomed to waking up early. So, we've been chatting this morning with Jafar Howie. Is it Howie or Howe?
Howe, the E is silent.
Howe, the E is silent.
Yeah.
I just learned that. So, Jafar Howe. Stay with us.